Good morning, student. Now we will learn the interior of the cranium part 2. In this, we will learn middle and posterior cranial fossa. So, first we will learn about the middle cranial fossa. So, you can see the shape of the middle cranial fossa. It is butterfly shape. You can see in the median plane it is shallow. On each side it is little bit deep. Now, which are the bones seen in the middle cranial fossa? We will learn one by one. Anteriorly, this is lesser wing of the sphenoid, this is anterior clinoid process, this part is known as sulcus chiasmaticus, this is the part of body of the sphenoid. Posteriorly, this is petrous part of temporal bone, here anterior surface, this is posterior surface, this part is also known as dorsum cella, that we will learn in detail. This is dorsum cella of the sphenoid bone. In the floor we can see anteriorly here, this is the greater wing of the sphenoid. This part is greater wing of the sphenoid bone. This is the squamous part of temporal bone. And somewhere here you can see some part of parietal bone also. So now we will see the feature of the middle cranial fossa. In the median plane first we will start. So this is sulcus chiasmaticus. On each side it is leading into towards the optic canal, that we have learned. This sulcus chiasmaticus, it is not occupying the sulcus optic chiasma. Optic chiasma, it is lying little behind and above the sulcus chiasmaticus, that we have to remember. This part is known as cella turcica. What is cella turcica? So this is upper part of the body of the sphenoid. It resembles the Turkish saddle. So we are giving the name of this part as cella turcica. It is having anterior part, middle part and posterior part. Anterior part, this part is known as tuberculum cella, this part is known as hypophyseal fossa and this part is known as dorsum cella. You can also say dorsal cella because spelling is S-E-L-L-A-E, so you can also say cella, cella, whatever you say. So this is tuberculum cella. It is separating the hypophyseal fossa from sulcus chiasmaticus. On each side of this tuberculum cella, this part is slightly prominent and this is known as middle clinoid process. This is anterior clinoid process, this is middle clinoid process. This part is having fossa, so this is known as hypophyseal fossa. It is lodging the pituitary gland. This is lodging the hypophysis cerebri, or you can see it is lodging the pituitary gland. Now this is dorsum cella, slightly elevated part again, and on each side of it again there is a slight elevation or it is prominent, and this part is forming the posterior clinoid process. What it is known as posterior clinoid process. So beneath this body of the, this is all part of body of the sphenoid. Beneath this there is a sphenoidal air sinus is located. Now we will see some features on the lateral part. Lateral part is little bit deep and it lodges the temporal lobe of the brain. It is related anteriorly to the orbit. This is superior orbital fissure through which it is related to the orbit. Inferiorly it is related to the infratemporal fossa. You can see this region is the region of infratemporal fossa. So we can say it is related inferiorly to infratemporal fossa, and on lateral side, so over this is the area of temporal fossa. So we can say it is lateral part it is related laterally to the temporal fossa. Now we will see the superior orbital fissure. Through this superior orbital fissure, middle cranial fossa communicate with the orbit. So how the superior orbital fissure is bounded? So upper boundary or superiorly it is bounded by lesser wing of the sphenoid, inferiorly this is greater wing of the sphenoid, and medially it is bounded by body of the sphenoid. Now one thing you have to remember, that on the inferior boundary or over the greater wing of the sphenoid, somewhere here you can see one prominent tubercle like structure. So this tubercle like structure, it is giving attachment to the tendinous ring of Zinn. And this tendinous ring of Zinn divides this superior orbital fissure into three parts: medial part, intermediate part and lateral part. Now we will see some of the features on the greater wing of the sphenoid bone. First we will see this is the foramen rotundum. This foramen, we can see this is the foramen rotundum, which is lying just behind the medial end of the superior orbital fissure. So this is foramen rotundum, and it is leading, or we can say it is opens anteriorly into the pterygopalatine fossa. Now we will see the another foramen, that is foramen ovale, that is known as foramen ovale, which is lying just behind and little bit lateral to the foramen rotundum. So this is foramen ovale. Just posterolateral to it, another foramen is seen. So this is known as foramen spinosum. You can see this is foramen spinosum. So you have to remember three foramen: foramen rotundum, foramen ovale, and foramen spinosum. So on this side we can see this is foramen rotundum, which is leading anteriorly towards the pterygopalatine fossa. This is foramen ovale, and this is foramen spinosum. These foramen are very important, frequently asked in the exam also. Now we will see one another feature which is seen on each side of the body of the spinoid. This is known as carotid groove. This is known as carotid groove. And now we will see one another foramen, that is, this is foramen lacerum. This is known as foramen lacerum. You can see that it is bounded by this greater wing. On one side it is bounded by this body of the spinoid, and posteriorly it is bounded by this apex of the petrous temporal bone. So this is foramen lacerum. Now we will see this is the petrous part of temporal bone. This is anterior surface. Now we will see the some of the features on the anterior surface of petrous part of temporal bone. So this is medially, just behind the foramen lacerum, you can see one cave-like structure, slight depression we can see. This is known as trigeminal cave. Trigeminal cave. On this side we can clearly see this is the trigeminal cave. It lodges trigeminal ganglion with its dural cave. Just lateral to it we can see two small foramen, that is hiatus for greater petrosal nerve and hiatus for lesser petrosal nerve. From that there is a one groove also leading, that we will now see. So this is trigeminal impressions. Just lateral to it, somewhere here there is a small opening. We cannot see in this, but you have to remember here there is a hiatus for greater petrosal nerve, and there is also groove for the same. This is the groove for the greater petrosal nerve. So we can say here there is a hiatus for the greater petrosal nerve, and just lateral to it another hiatus is there for the hiatus for lesser petrosal nerve. It is leading toward the foramen spinosum. So you have to remember three structure: trigeminal impression, then hiatus and groove for the greater petrosal nerve, which is leading toward the foramen lacerum. Just lateral to it there is a hiatus and groove for the lesser petrosal nerve, that is leading toward the foramen spinosum. So these are the structure on the anterior surface of the lesser petrous temporal bone. So this is another skull. In this we can see clearly the hiatus and groove for these two nerves. So this is the groove, and somewhere here is the hiatus for greater petrosal nerve, which is leading toward the foramen lacerum. This is the groove, and somewhere here is the hiatus for the lesser petrosal nerve, which is leading toward the foramen spinosum. Now we will see another feature on the petrous temporal bone. Just lateral to the groove for the lesser petrosal nerve, this elevation we can see, this is known as arcuate eminence. This arcuate eminence, it is produced by the superior semicircular canal. Now just anterolateral to the arcuate eminence, so this part of bone, this part of petrous part of temporal bone, it is known as tegmen tympani. Now you have to remember it is forming the roof of the tympanic antrum, tympanic cavity, and canal for tensor tympani muscle. So you have to remember this tegmen tympani, it is forming the roof of the tympanic antrum, tympanic cavity, and canal for tensor tympani muscle. All these things you will learn during the middle year. Now we will see some applied anatomy of middle cranial fossa. If there is a fracture of the middle cranial fossa, it may lead to bleeding and discharge of CSF through ear. Bleeding through the nose or mouth also occurs if there is involvement of sphenoidal body. 7 and 8 cranial nerve, they may be damaged if there is a fracture line passing through the internal acoustic meatus. This is internal acoustic meatus that we will learn in the posterior cranial fossa. But if fracture line passes through internal acoustic meatus, then it may lead to the damage of 7th and 8th cranial nerve, which may lead to deafness and vertigo. So this is about the feature of the middle cranial fossa. Now we will learn about the structure passing through foramina and some important attachment. Middle cranial fossa lodges the temporal lobe of the cerebral hemisphere. So here there will be the lodgment of temporal lobe. Now this is the lesser wing of the spinoid bone. Into this lesser wing of the spinoid there is a occupation athwa, or you can say there is a lodgment of stem of the lateral sulcus. Now tuberculum cella, where is tuberculum cella? So this is the tuberculum cella and this is dorsum cella. So this is giving attachment to the diaphragma cellis. Diaphragma cell is another circular dural fold. So anteriorly it is attached to the tuberculum cella, posteriorly it is attached to the dorsum cella. Now somewhere here we have talk about this posterior cleaner process. It is giving attachment to the anterior end of the attached margin of tentorium cerebelli. Tentorium cerebelli attached margin is attached like this. Superior border of petrous temporal bone here, and anteriorly this attached to the posterior cleaner process. So posterior cleaner process is also giving attachment to another ligament that is known as petrosphenoidal ligament. That you have to remember, petrosphenoidal ligament. Now the location of the cavernous sinus. So on each side of the body of the spinoid, somewhere here there is a location of the cavernous sinus. And through the cavernous sinus, we will learn later on, internal carotid artery passes like this. And another important structure that you have to remember is, along the superior border of the petrous temporal bone, you can see here there is a groove for the superior petrosal sinus, that you have to remember. And over this, there is also attachment of the attached margin of tentorium cerebelli that we have learned. So now we will see the structure passing through the superior orbital fissure. We have just talked about the division of the superior orbital fissure, medial, intermediate and lateral part. So first we will see the structure passing through lateral part. So here from the lateral part there is a passage of three nerves, LFT, lacrimal nerve, frontal nerve and trochlear nerve. One vein, that is superior ophthalmic vein, is also passing through it, and there is also passage of meningeal branch of lacrimal artery and anastomotic branch of middle meningeal artery, which anastomosis with the recurrent branch of lacrimal artery. Now structure passing through the middle part. So from the middle part there is a passage of upper and lower division of oculomotor nerve, nasociliary nerve in between the two divisions of oculomotor nerve, and abducens nerve infralateral to the all above structures. From the medial part there is a passage of inferior ophthalmic vein and sympathetic nerve and plexus around the internal carotid arteries. Now this is foramen rotundum. Through this foramen rotundum there is a passage of maxillary nerve which is going toward the pterygopalatine fossa. Now we will see the structure passing through foramen ovale. This structure you will also learn during the norma basalis, but here also we will learn. So from the foramen ovale we remember the mnemonic male, MALE, but in the exam you are not supposed to say male. You have to speak the structure like mandibular nerve. M means mandibular nerve, A means accessory meningeal artery, L means lesser petrosal nerve, and E for emissary vein which is connecting the cavernous sinus with the pterygoid venous plexus. Sometimes there is also passage of anterior division of middle meningeal vein. So these are the structure passing through foramen ovale. From the foramen spinosum there is a passage of middle meningeal artery, nervus spinosus, or you can say meningeal branch of mandibular nerve, and posterior division of middle meningeal vein. And from this side we can see clearly there is a groove leading from the this lesser so this foramen spinosum, and there is a groove leading from it. This is for the middle meningeal vessels. Now structure passing through foramen lacerum. So during life, lower part of this foramen, it is filled with the cartilage and no significant structure passing through the foramen except for the meningeal branch of ascending pharyngeal artery and one emissary vein from the cavernous sinus. But upper part of the foramen, it is traversed by internal carotid arteries. This is carotid groove. So somewhere here there is a occupation of this internal carotid artery. And there is also passage of venous and sympathetic plexus around internal carotid artery. So these are the structure passing through foramen lacerum. Now you have to remember that in the anterior part of foramen lacerum, there is a posterior opening of pterygoid canal. That will you learn during norma basalis. So now, right now you remember that in the anterior part of foramen lacerum, there is a union of two nerves, greater petrosal nerve and deep petrosal nerve. They are uniting in the anterior part of foramen lacerum and they form nerve of pterygoid canal that is going to the pterygoid canal. That will you learn in the norma basalis. So this is all about the middle cranial fossa, feature, structure passing through foramen and important attachment.